Hello everyone, in this video we will cover electromagnetic radiation and why it is the basis of many of the imaging technologies that you will encounter in this course. It is part of our everyday life because visible light, infrared and ultraviolet light and radio waves, as well as X-rays and gamma rays, are all types of electromagnetic radiation. So what is electromagnetic radiation? It consists of two perpendicular fields, an electric field and a magnetic field. The two fields are sinusoidal and in phase, which means that as they oscillate, they both pass through zero at the same point in time. The energy moves or propagates in the direction K, which is perpendicular to the two oscillating fields. The wavelength is the distance required to complete one full cycle of the wave, and we call this lambda, and this is the Greek symbol for lambda. Electromagnetic radiation has an important property. It is self-propagating. Simply put, the oscillating magnetic field produces an oscillating electric field, and the oscillating electric field produces an oscillating magnetic field. This means that it doesn't need the source to continue to add energy, unlike other forms of EM fields, such as magnetic fields or static electricity. These only occur close to the source. On the contrary, once electromagnetic radiation has been produced, the transmitter can no longer influence it, and it will continue to move in a straight line unless it encounters something that can slow it down, stop it, or absorb it. Today, we take for granted that light and other forms of electromagnetic radiation carry energy. But let us look at the history of the science surrounding EM radiation in just over the last 150 years. In 1865, Maxwell published a dynamical theory of the electromagnetic field. He discovered that light is a wave. In 1900, Max Planck proposed that the energy in light could only be emitted or absorbed in discrete amounts. That is, the energy of light is quantized. It is not done in random amounts. This was the beginning of what we now call quantum theory. Importantly, Planck also recognized that the energy was related to the frequency of the light. Until then, it was thought that it was the intensity of the light that determined how it interacted with matter. Planck's equation defines that relationship, whereby the energy is directly proportional to the frequency, and the proportionality constant, H, is now called Planck's constant. In 1905, Einstein went a step further by stating that light has mass and momentum, and demonstrated it through the photoelectric effect, whereby light could displace an electron and cause a current to flow. He postulated that light consisted of particles, just like electrons. Then in 1923, Compton showed that light could be scattered by an electron, demonstrating that light indeed travelled as a particle. The importance of this is demonstrated by the Nobel Prizes. Maxwell himself was too early, but is often described as the third most influential physicist of all time. In 1919, Max Planck received the Nobel Prize for the theory that light is quantized. In 1921, Einstein received the Nobel Prize for the photoelectric effect, in which he explained the interaction between photons and electrons. And then in 1927, Compton received the Nobel Prize for demonstrating that light could be scattered by hitting an electron. You will note the length of time that passed between discovery and the recognition for Planck and Einstein. These ideas contradicted everything that had been taught in classical physics. But by the time Compton came along, the wave-particle theory of light was widely accepted, and it was only 4 years before he was acknowledged with his Nobel Prize. Let us now consider some of the important properties of electromagnetic radiation. It moves at a speed that we all know as the speed of light, which has the symbol c. In a vacuum, this is 300 million, or 3 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. Some of you may have learnt 186,000 miles per second, but in this course we will use SI units, which are based on metric units. We will also use shorthand nomenclature, such as 3E8 meters seconds to the minus 1. This means exactly the same thing. When electromagnetic radiation moves into transparent materials, it slows down. This is important because this results in refraction, which causes the radiation to bend. The degree to which it slows down is dependent on the frequency, and it is very sensitive. We have all observed the diffraction of light by a prism, or even a rainbow. EM radiation can also interact with the electrons and the nuclei in a material to cause it to be absorbed. This energy can be transferred to the electron or the nucleus, or converted to another form of energy, such as heat. We will discover later that transparency and absorption are functions of frequency, or alternatively, the energy of the photons. And so something that is not transparent to visible light may be transparent to EM radiation at a higher frequency, such as X-rays. The speed of any wave is the product of its frequency and wavelength. For EM radiation, the equation becomes C equals nu times lambda. Alternatively, we can say that frequency is inversely proportional to wavelength. This means that as the frequency gets higher, the wavelength gets shorter. In the next exercise, you will investigate further the relationship between frequency and wavelength.